Welcome to Palm Sunday weekend. I've already taken the liberty of changing Lego Man's vestment to the correct color for today, to red. Today is known as either Palm Sunday or Passion Sunday, and we wear red as a reminder of the blood that was shed by our Lord Jesus when he endured his passion for our salvation. And we're invited to enter very deeply into this mystery during this upcoming Holy Week as we approach the celebration of Easter this upcoming Sunday. So to enter into this mystery today, I'd like to focus primarily on the second reading from Mass. Philippians is considered to be one of Paul's prison letters, meaning that St. Paul wrote this letter while he was under arrest. Although Paul's experience wasn't quite like our concept of going to jail. At the time, prisons were generally of three varieties, ranging from really bad to not terribly bad at all. Paul's prison was probably called by the Romans custodia militaris, if I got that pronunciation right, or military custody. This meant that Paul was probably chained to the military officer on duty in order to ensure he wouldn't get away, but it also meant that Paul could have probably been living in an ordinary household while being chained to the guard. Now, you and I aren't wearing chains right now, but we're kind of stuck in our household with the same people. So St. Paul's experience is similar enough, I think, to warrant a comparison between him and us. So if you're looking for a way to keep the Lord's Day holy today, I'd just like you to invite you to read the entire letter to the Philippians today. It's only four chapters long. Get inside St. Paul's mind. See what occupied his thoughts during this imprisonment of his. And perhaps ask yourself the question, what could you spend these days in quarantine praying with, thinking about, mulling over? Perhaps even make a list of those questions or ideas that stand out to you from reflection upon St. Paul's letter to the Philippians. And take time in these upcoming days to reflect on each of these questions. Here's one idea that St. Paul brings up that I would recommend putting on your list to sit with for a while this week. In Philippians 2:5, Paul essentially tells the Philippians to put on the mind of Christ. What does the mind of Christ look like? Good question. St. Paul answers it. We hear the answer immediately afterward in our second reading for today. Philippians 2, chapters 6, or verses 6 to 11, which says, Christ Jesus, though he was in the form of God, emptied himself, humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death. That's that reading in a nutshell. This is the mind of Christ in a nutshell. Let's break this apart. Though he was in the form of God. If this was a normal Palm Sunday, you would have probably heard two Gospels at Mass today. The first one being at the start before the procession with all the palms. And that first Gospel for today is Matthew's account of Jesus riding into Jerusalem on a donkey. Matthew points out that this event recalls a prophecy from Zechariah chapter 9, where the king rides in on a donkey. When Jesus fulfilled this prophecy, he knew precisely what he was doing. In fulfilling this prophecy, Jesus shows that he knew he was the awaited king, the Messiah. As we hear in the Gospel of John, Jesus knew he was sent by the Father, and he knew that he and the Father were one. So he knew he was God. Or to use St. Paul's description, he was in the form of God. Now, knowing this, what did Jesus do? He emptied himself. He emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, coming in human likeness. We know that Jesus is the Word of God. He is in need of nothing. But he didn't leave us eternally hanging after sin entered the world. He came in human form, taking on our human nature. Still fully God, yet also becoming fully man. In order that we could be rescued from sin and dwell eternally with him in heaven. He stopped at nothing to accomplish this, humbling himself and becoming obedient to the point of death, death on a cross. Jesus completely set aside his own needs, pleasures, and comforts in order to fulfill our eternal needs. Now, as a disciple of Jesus, St. Paul lived this same attitude in his own life. It also seems that his imprisonment helped to kind of force this self-emptying as well. Because when you're in prison, you either allow yourself to be emptied, since freedoms are already taken away, or you go crazy. St. Paul is speaking from his own experience of putting on the mind of Christ in this letter. This was inspired and guided by the Holy Spirit who lived in him. And he tells the Philippians to adopt this same attitude in their life. Again, we hear in Philippians, "Have among yourselves the same attitude that is also yours in Christ Jesus." And today, through these inspired words, the Holy Spirit is inviting you and me to do the same. That being said, let's get practical. What can you do to adopt this mind of Christ Jesus? Well, first and foremost, pray, because only Jesus can make that change within you. But until then, here's a couple things that we can begin to live now, even as we may continue to wrestle with a mind and a heart that might try to resist. We hear in Philippians 2, verses 3 and 4, they tell us a practical way to empty ourselves like Jesus or like St. Paul. Those verses have a quote that says, "Do nothing out of selfishness or out of vainglory." My question would be this: can you name one thing you did this past week out of selfishness? Or could you name several? Perhaps maybe do you see a pattern of selfishness in particular circumstances? What could you change for this upcoming week to disrupt that pattern of selfishness and to begin establishing a new pattern of selflessness? Often, we act selfishly because we look to our own needs first. So, to grow in humility, St. Paul follows up with, "Humbly regard others as more important than yourselves." Note the shift from selfish to selfless. Humbly regard others as more important than yourselves, each looking out not for his own interests, but also everyone for those of others. The logical consequence is this: if everyone looks out for everyone else, then everyone else is looking out for you. The Philippians did this for St. Paul. A little later in chapter 2, Paul actually speaks of how this guy named Epaphroditus was sent by the Philippians to help Paul during his imprisonment. We can all do the same. We may not be able to go and visit people right now, but during this time in Corona house arrest, have you reached out to neighbors in need, whether that's through a phone call or whether that's offering to go and get groceries for someone who might be more vulnerable than you are? Maybe they just need a person to talk to on the phone. You know, if you need something, if you're aware in your heart of something that you need right now, someone else probably is in need too. And you may not be able to be in a position to fill all of your own needs at the moment, but perhaps you're in a position where you can help to fill someone else's needs. So these are two things that we can look to do starting right now, setting aside selfishness and looking to the needs of others around us in all humility. But when it comes to that internal attitude of heart, we will feel that wrestling against the internal surrender. There is something inside us that resists putting on the mind of Christ. So for your prayer in the days to come, I would like to take the conclusion here to offer two truths to ask the Holy Spirit to really burn into your mind and into your heart so that you can joyfully put on the mind of Christ. First, I'd like to take this wonderful line from the first reading from Isaiah chapter 50. It says, "The Lord God is my help, therefore I am not disgraced." The all-powerful, all-knowing, all-loving God is our help. That doesn't mean he answers prayers in the ways that we might expect, But it does mean that our eternal salvation is in His hands. He has not stopped, and He will not stop providing for you, whatever your circumstances. And He will provide for you in light of the eternal salvation that He wishes to give to you. The truth to ask the Holy Spirit to burn into us is that the Lord God is your help. He is looking out for your needs, and you will not be abandoned by Him. A second truth that may be helpful. Let's look one more time at the letter to the Philippians. Look at what happened as a result of Jesus emptying Himself and humbling Himself. Philippians says, "Because of this, God greatly exalted Him and bestowed on Him the name which is above every name, that every knee should bend of those in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." This exalting, this lifting up, it's not just a normal lifting up of something or someone. Jesus was raised and exalted to the right hand of the throne of God the Father. There is no higher place available. It's God's desire to exalt and lift us up as well. He desires us to turn to Him, to put on this mind of Christ, and He desires to lift us up in Christ to the heavenly heights as well. So a second truth to ask the Holy Spirit to burn into our hearts and minds today is this: the glories of these heavenly heights, which we have not seen, these heavenly heights are worth persevering through any self-emptying, through any humility, through any suffering. May the Lord begin to burn these truths into us today and in the days to come as we prepare for Easter. And may He bring this work to completion as we set ourselves aside and look out for the needs of others, so that we may live with the mind of Christ in complete freedom and joy. God bless you all. Have a happy and holy Week.